Hey everyone, before we get into this video, I want to remind you to enter our Paper Mario the Origami King giveaway. To enter, all you need to do is comment on this video, like the video, subscribe to the channel, and hit that bell icon. We will announce the winner at the end of July. Now, today we get an interesting look at something that I don't think is that typical in the world of gaming, and that is financial aspects of Nintendo that tell us what the top people get paid. And the reason that this matters is because Nintendo operates very differently from most other video game companies. And you're going to notice that when we actually take a look at these numbers, because we also have additional numbers. There's a lot to look at. Let's just get into what Nintendo's execs make, because honestly, it's a little surprising because I thought they would be making a different figure. So let's take a look. So as you see here, Nintendo's directors earn a relatively modest wage compared to other industry execs. All right, so this was reported by Nintendo, and then Daniel Ahmed on Twitter kind of translated everything, got it into USD for purposes. And here's what it comes down to. Shintaro Furukawa, who is the CEO of Nintendo, the president of Nintendo of Japan. Basically, he is the highest exec position you can have in all of Nintendo, so he's going to make more money than anyone. He made $2.4 million in the last fiscal year, which was $0.73 million, so $730,000 as a base income, so no matter what, he makes that. And then he got $1.67 million as a bonus, and this is usually based on earnings and all that. So basically, the better the company does, the bigger the bonus is going to be. Shigeru Miyamoto, it's the second most amount of money at the company. No surprise there. He made $1.8 million with $670,000 as his basic income. And then he made a $1.13 million bonus. And then Shinya Takahashi, who's like the third guy, you know, who's like the three-headed monster that runs Nintendo of Japan, made $1.24 million or $110,000. In terms of base income, and then $1.13 million bonus. I see, obviously, Miyamoto and Furukawa are well ahead of everyone, but like Miyamoto's like the face of Nintendo, and Furukawa is obviously the CEO, so that's not too surprising. You get kind of a look at it here, performance-based compensation versus fixed compensation, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Now, don't get me wrong, millions of dollars is a lot of money. You know, you get 2+ million, 1.8, 1.24, that's a lot of money compared to someone like me, compared to probably almost everyone watching this video. But it's actually really modest, really, really modest. If you look at things like a report from last year, it even points out here, Activision CEO Bobby Kotick and EA CEO Andrew Wilson both took home around $30 million, which is more than 300 times the average wage of their employees. We all know, obviously, about how Iwata, when Nintendo was doing poorly, actually cut his pay by 50% instead of firing employees. Now, we also have this part here, which is the average age and salary of the employees at Nintendo. Just to put this in comparison here, you know, you got $2.4 million being made by the CEO of all of Nintendo, and the average money per employee is $86,583. And now Nintendo does have 2,395 total employees, and the average age is just a tad under 40 years old at 39.2 years. Also, the average length that people stay at Nintendo is essentially at 14 years. So when you're hired at Nintendo, you're there for a very significant amount of time, especially when you compare to like Western companies where you might be on contracts for 2, 3, 4, 5 years and then you're done. Nintendo, that's almost like a lifetime. 14 years is a long time to be with a single company. But yeah, 86,583 is the average versus 2.4 million for the CEO. That's really not that bad. Obviously, the person at the top is always going to make the most. That's the way it works in every company. They have a lot of pressure on them, a lot more pressure than, say, a random employee at the Nintendo Treehouse. But yeah, needless to say, everyone at Nintendo is compensated pretty well in comparison to what the CEO makes. This is also why Nintendo, in my opinion, is able to do things that Activision and EA and other companies can't, and that is retain employees. Famously, Activision was in the midst of their most profitable year of all time last year, and they still felt like they needed to lay off, you know, 700 plus employees, while the CEO is banking $30 million. Like, does it make sense? most profitable we've ever been, let's fire everyone. Like, it doesn't make any sense unless you're just extremely greedy. And Nintendo, when it comes to paying their employees, is modest. $2.4 million is a lot to pay any person, but this is a person running a multi-billion dollar company. It's really not that bad. I kind of expected it to be a little higher. I thought he might be making closer to $5 million. So, yeah, this is really nice to see that Nintendo tends to take the money they make, and besides putting some in the bank, because they always put money in the bank, they let the wages kind of trickle down throughout the chain, so there's not that big of a wage gap between the lowest person on the totem pole, which is probably like a QA tester in some random country or whatever. So you probably have a QA tester making between, you know, 30 to 50,000 or somewhere in there, maybe a little bit less than that. I'm not sure what Nintendo's playing their QA testers, because I haven't been hired as one for them. I know when I used to do QA testing for a different company that, for contractual reasons I can't say, I was getting paid about 28,000. So, you know, QA testing might be the lowest on their totem pole, but then, like, you know, going on up the line, you know, you're to, you know, a translating position at Nintendo Treehouse, or you know, you're whatever, a localization team or something, or an actual game developer, chances are you're making a pretty decent amount of money working for Nintendo. And that is probably why people that join Nintendo don't tend to leave very often. In fact, they leave other companies to join Nintendo. Like, if you remember Jose Otero, he used to be a kind of a big Nintendo guy. He ran the whole Nintendo division over at IGN, probably making a decent wage, maybe 50, 60, 70,000 a year or so. He left IGN to work for Nintendo. One, because it was his dream job. Two, I'm sure Nintendo's compensating him pretty well. And he'll probably be there maybe for the rest of his professional career. Now, we've obviously seen a number of employees leave Nintendo over the last couple of years. And I feel like this is pretty common, because there's a changing of the guard at Nintendo. Obviously, Reggie Fils-Aimé retired, so that's one thing. So someone else, you know, Doug Bowser's running Nintendo of America. And obviously, we had a changing of the guard at the very top of Nintendo. Thanks, you know, well, sadly, because of Iwata's passing, you know, they went through a temporary CEO in Takahashi, and then they moved on to their current one in Furukawa. So there's been a little shuffling at the top, which naturally leads to some people deciding that they might want to move on because they don't like the way things are being managed now or whatever. You know, we've had the director of Indie Guys move on to other companies. We've had a couple guys at Treehouse leave. But in general, employees stay at Nintendo a hell of a long time. And yeah, it's because of the culture Nintendo cultivates, and it's because that they aren't greedy bastards at the top. Is it fair to call that about EA and Activision? You know, I don't know Bobby Kotick, I don't know Andrew Wilson, but I think it's safe to say they're pretty damn greedy when they're bringing home $30 million, even if a majority of it's a bonus. I don't really care. And I get that EA and Activision might overall have better revenue sheets and make more money than Nintendo, but I find it all shady and just yucky and disgusting how they do it with the microtransactions and all that, and just how they generally don't seem to care as much about their employees as Nintendo does. And this, I'm not trying to knock anyone. I actually know developers that have worked for, you know, Activision Blizzard and have worked for EA that actually feel like they're treated pretty well there. But this is pretty well in comparison to other Western companies that treat their employees super, super shitty. So it's like, yeah, maybe they treat their employees better in comparison to there, but how do they treat them in comparison to Nintendo? I don't know. It seems like people are pretty happy at Nintendo and are kind of lifers when they join the company. So take that for what it is. Also, Nintendo is a little backwards in how they work in the industry. So a lot of studios, a lot of game makers do contractual hires where they hire you for a set number, a period of time, whether it's 3 months, 6 months, a year, 3 years, 5 years, or just for one specific project. And then when that project goes gold and wraps up, that's it. Your contract comes to an end. Maybe you get a bonus on the sales or the Metacritic rating, but the position kind of ends at that point. No, maybe they rehire you and bring you on. Nintendo doesn't tend to do that. They tend to just say, hey, look, come work for us, and here's your base salary, and there you go. You work with us until we either don't feel like you're doing your job and let you go, or until you decide to move on. Nintendo's very different. They don't do a lot of temporary hires. Now, they have actually done temporary hiring at things like Retro Studios. Retro Studios seems to be the one studio Nintendo owns that runs very much like a traditional Western studio, so they have a lot of employees that come in and out for every project. And that's pretty typical. You know, you look at Naughty Dog, you look at any other major Western individual studio like that, there's a lot of turnover. So Nintendo does have that occur at their company, but it still doesn't seem to affect the bottom line when you see 14 years of service, 86,000 per average. Like that's all decent right there. So 2.4 million at the top, 1.8 million for Shigeru Miyamoto. Takahashi rocking in at, you know, just the over 1.2 million. I honestly think that this is what makes Nintendo Nintendo. It starts at the top, it works its way down, and yeah, that's great. Like, I'm actually really curious what you guys think about this, how Nintendo handles business in comparison to other Western studios. I wish I could comment more on like how Nintendo handles it compared to Microsoft, but again, Microsoft is a very different business. I have no idea what Phil Spencer gets paid to run Xbox. We have no clue, and I don't know how Sony handles things. Their company also does more than video games. So Nintendo is video games only, basically. And, you know, so I feel like it's fairer to compare them to other video game only companies, whereas Sony and Microsoft are not that. So I'm not sure their CEOs are going to get paid more because it's a totally different business. But thank you guys so much for tuning in. Let me know what you think about this down in the comments below. Do you think this is a good guy, Nintendo? Or do you just think this is just, they're a Japanese company, so this is what they do. Let me know what you think. I am Nathaniel Robichance from Nintendo Prime, and I'll catch each and every single one of you guys in the next video. Or live stream, whichever happens first.